This is the Brother Henry and You Show, where you can be inspired, uplifted, and edified through the Word of God. Now enjoy today's program. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, and we know that all things work together for the good. To them that love God, to them that are called according to His purpose. You love God, right? You are called according to His purpose, right? What's going to work out for the good? Why are you wearing? I told the church a few weeks back, actually last week, I said a lot of things that we worry about, we have no control over. Why not just put it in the hands of God? It's going to work out for your good, no matter what it is that you're facing today. Trust God, believe God for the supernatural. Trust God for the spontaneous blessings that's about to come your way, my friend. Welcome to the Brother Henry You Show. My name is Brother Henry Harris. Thank you so much for taking this opportunity today to watch. I know that the Lord has a word for you. I know there's going to be something that will be said that's going to prick your heart, that's going to touch your heart, and only the Holy Spirit can do that. So it's a blessing to be here today. I have my sister Tara Frazier here with me today. She attends God's Glory Tabernacle International here in Pineville, Missouri, under the leadership of Pastor Bill Hackworth. So it's an honor to have you.
Thank you for having me.
And I'm excited to hear what the Lord has to share through her. And if you're watching this video, go ahead and share it. Go ahead and let your friends know that we're about to have a great time in the Lord right here on the Brother Henry You Show. Before we do that, I'd like to say a prayer for you. Father, I thank you for those that are watching right now. I pray, Lord, there be something that will be said, Lord, that will touch their hearts. They'll walk away, Lord, encouraged and not discouraged, lifted up and not down. Father, we just praise you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace, Lord. Lord, you're merciful, you're gracious, you're so kind, so loving. Lord, you give us so many chances, even when we mess up, even when we fall, you're there to pick us up. Father, I give you the praise, and I thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Again, we have Sister Tara Frazier with us today, and it's an honor to have you here.
Well, thank you.
We talked a little bit before this taping, and I tell you, she's going on and on and on. I said, I think we need to hit the camera, because this girl got a word in her. And she was telling me, well, I believe you need to hear what the Lord is doing in your life. And I would like to start out with that. Would you mind just elaborating on what the Lord is doing through you and talk about your women's Bible study? And
yes.
If there's a word you feel like you want to share, just take your time.
Okay. Yeah. We're having our second women's Bible meeting here at God's Glory Tabernacle, and I had my first one a few weeks ago. We do it every other Tuesday night here at 7 to 9 p.m. You don't have to attend this church. You don't even have to attend a church. We are just so excited to get any women in the door to fellowship. Right now, what we're studying is Great Women of the Bible. We started with Sarah last session.
I bet that was interesting.
It was. And you'd be surprised, Henry, at what, you know, we all hear these stories as children of Abraham and Moses, and but as we get older, we kind of lose touch with those stories. Mm-hmm. You don't go to a lot of churches where pastors are telling the children's Bible stories, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes it's good to touch back and mm-hmm. research that and just remind yourself at what awesome, courageous people of God these people were, and all the adversities that they faced and had to overcome,
mm-hmm.
and their faithfulness to God, man, got them through so much stuff. Sarah, you know, last week, people were just blown away at just how faithful she was to God.
That was Abraham's wife.
That was Abraham's wife, mm-hmm. and God kept telling her she was going to have a baby, and for years, for like 20 years, he promised her this, and she stayed faithful and followed Abraham wherever he traveled, and she eventually did. God kept his word to her, and she had a baby. I'm not exactly right, but she was up there close to 100 when she finally had a baby.
Yeah,
boy.
She was around there.
Yeah, and you know, it was her heart's desire. It was all she wanted. And then tonight we're studying Jochebed,
mm-hmm.
which is Moses' mother, and Miriam, which is Moses' sister, which
mm-hmm.
helped Moses and Aaron lead the people out of Egypt, and
mm-hmm.
She, Miriam, was actually a prophetess.
Mm-hmm.
And she's one of the first recorded prophetess in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
One of the first recorded song in the Bible was part of that was sung by Miriam.
Mm-hmm.
The day that they were celebrating after they had crossed the Red Sea, Moses is part of the Red
mm-hmm.
Sea, and all the soldiers had fallen into the sea and got swallowed up, and they were saved, and they were all rejoicing. But she's an amazing woman, and she was not without her faults.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she let her power there go to her head a little bit, and God had to kind of bring her back down. But hey, that just reminds us that we're just like these women in the Bible. There, we put them up on a pedestal, but really, they were awesome women of God. But they're with faults, just like we are. You know, they're not perfect. God had to forgive them. God had to swoop in and rescue them sometimes. Just like Sarah, He rescued Sarah multiple times from having to be enslaved as another man's wife. Abraham would move to another town, a new town, and he'd be afraid that he'd be killed off because Sarah was this beautiful woman, and people would kill him to try to get to her to marry her.
Mm-hmm.
So everywhere they went, he made her pretend he was her brother, which they were actually half brother and sister, but just so he wouldn't get killed. And a couple of times she got taken away and went to live with a king and his harlem is, I think that's what but God had to step in and rescue her a couple times. But yeah, it's just an awesome time to fellowship. And I feel called to women. I've always had a place for women in my heart. I just relate to women. I love to hear their stories of what they're going through. I love to share my story.
I like how you say it, relate. We seldom ever see that happening, especially with believers.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about that earlier, how a lot of Christians are up here, and they're so high that they can't come down.
Exactly.
And there are a lot of people, hey, you need to come off your high horse.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I got some serious issues, and I need somebody that's been through what I went through.
Yes.
And I believe these women, they like that.
Nobody wants to talk to a perfect person.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody, no one's going to open up and share their struggles and what they're going through to a person who has it all together.
Mm-hmm.
No one's going to do that. It's
mm-hmm.
going to make them feel bad about themselves and
mm-hmm.
make them just remind them of how they're not measuring up.
Mm-hmm.
Women especially, they open up better to, and they want to know that who they're talking to and sharing with is going to relate to them
mm-hmm.
and has been through some of those struggles and understands those struggles and doesn't judge them for those struggles
mm-hmm.
and that can help them and pray with them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I come in, where I feel like my calling is.
Oh, that's awesome. when did the Lord birth this in you about this? Has it been an ongoing thing, or you're just now stepping out into it? Did he tell you to do this before, but you was like, well, I need to make sure this is him?
No, actually, this is it's pretty new. It was a struggle. It was a rocky road to get here. We were discussing earlier, I'm actually going through a very heartbreaking divorce. About 7 months ago, my husband, you know, came home from work one day
mm-hmm.
and out of the blue took off work early and showed up at home and told me he wanted a divorce, didn't
mm-hmm.
love me anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I was devastated. My world was shattered, at the least. You're married, you can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
It was tough. It was a tough thing. But, you know, my church, my faith, my family, all those things helped me pick up the pieces. So a few months after that, I really started to do some soul searching and praying. And I wanted a purpose. I wanted to do something. I craved to serve.
Mm-hmm.
I craved for a calling. And I discussed a lot of it with my pastor and his wife on what to do and how to step into my calling. And I'll tell you, it's funny when people talk about having an epiphanies, or they just wake up one day and they knew that was me.
Mm-hmm.
I woke up one day a few months ago and I just knew
mm-hmm.
I was supposed to start a women's Bible study. I'm supposed to serve with women. I'm supposed to lead women, help women. And I talked to Bill about it and my pastor, and the ball just got rolling. And really, it all came together pretty quickly. Within a few short weeks, I had my first meeting and I was in it and doing it. And
mm-hmm.
I haven't looked back since. And
I
love it. It's so healing, too. These women, they
you
think
that. You talked about that, was it a few Sundays ago, where you said as you listen to other women, it helps heal you.
Most definitely. These women think that I'm helping them, and I am, you know, I hope I'm helping them. I mm-hmm. want to help them. But what they don't realize is, oh man, how much they're doing for me, how mm-hmm. much they're helping me heal with my situation, hearing their stories and how strong they have and the situations that they've been through and that they've overcome. And if they can do it, I can do it, you know, and vice versa. And I knew, and I really feel like the Lord actually spoke to me and told me before I did this, and he told me, if you do this, if you step up in the calling and you do this, you will be healed. This mm-hmm. is going to be your healing. This is going to be the gift of healing I give to you. You do this, you serve, you help these women, and that's going to help heal you. Mm-hmm. And I knew it, and it has. It's done wonders.
I'm glad you referred to your calling as a struggle, because a lot of people, and I don't know about anybody else, but when the Lord called me to preach, I knew the Lord had that calling on my life, but just like you, it was a struggle for me, and I didn't really fulfill that calling until I was about 16. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very important that people would know that a lot of times when God tells you to do something, you're not going to automatically want to go out and do it.
No, sometimes you just got to take that leap of faith.
Yeah.
And it is, and it's almost like a relief when you finally do it. And it's almost like this has been building up. And I always know, man, the Holy Ghost gets me good. I always know when there's something that I'm supposed to do or say, or maybe it might even be just a word that I'm supposed to give in church. And it's almost like, it's hard to describe. It's almost like you just are on fire inside, and it's just you're bursting at the seams to say and get it out, because you just, you know, if you don't, you're not going to have that relief. You're just going to feel that. And, but yeah, it's not always easy. It is a struggle. Everything worth doing, you're going to have struggles. Mm-hmm. Anything good, there's always going to be. Satan's always going to come and try to steal your glory. Man, he came here to steal, kill, and destroy, and mm-hmm. I'm no exception. My Bible study's no exception. You know, he tries to throw roadblocks left and right, but the important thing is that I realize it's him.
Amen.
And I don't doubt myself or my faith or my God, and I just,
you're still standing. That's what's important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A lot of times the storm comes, the wind comes, the first thing people want to do, I'm giving up.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say to a person that's to that verge at the end of their rope? Even that woman that may be going through the process, what you're going through, it may be hard for them to process all these things that they're going through in their life. What seed that you can sow into your life right now that would help them get through this journey?
The most important thing I've learned or experienced with my situation and feeling like you want to give up and feeling like there's no hope and you're heartbroken and you're devastated and how am I ever going to go on? How am I going to do this? Is sometimes you just got to push through those walls. And I'll tell you, you know, I don't like to talk a lot about Satan or give him a lot of power. And Bill always says that, and I kind of stole that from him, because who is Satan? We don't need to talk about him. But the fact of the matter is, you do need to be aware of what his tactics, I guess. Mm-hmm. I read an interesting Joyce Meyer's article mm-hmm. a few weeks ago about just being aware of Satan's tactics, how he works. And if you can be aware of those things and you can arm yourself with that, those are going to help you in those situations mm-hmm. that you face when you feel like you want to give up. Mm-hmm. God never wants us to feel like that. He's never going to put us in a situation where we feel hopeless or sad or depressed. That's all of the devil. That's mm-hmm. him coming in and feeding those ugly little lies in your head and mm-hmm. telling you, give up, give up. And man, don't you know, if you did give up, he'd just love it. He won.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't give up. You just got to keep going. And a lot of times, he'll attack right when you're about at the verge of a big breakthrough or something great's just right on the edge. That's mm-hmm. when he comes at you the hardest.
Mm-hmm.
And so really, you should almost be flattered at that and just mm-hmm. think, yeah, I must got good things coming my way. And you just got to keep pushing through.
I think the Bible talks about how we need to rejoice when we're going through trials and tribulations. I think it's a great thing.
Yeah.
My grandmother used to always say that if you're not being attacked by Satan or the enemy, you may want to check your walk with Christ.
Yeah.
I don't know if any person... And this is one thing that I really hate. When I first gave my life to the Lord, people always say, oh, give your life to Jesus Christ. It's like eating ice cream and some chocolate chip cookies. It's just so easy. And those people, they lied to me. It's not easy.
You're still waiting for the ice cream.
Yeah, it's not easy.
Yeah, it's not. It's not always a bed of roses. It's not always, everything's not always going to go your way. But nobody has anything that ever goes their way. And the most important thing to remember or to rely on is that the great thing about being a Christian and following Christ is when those situations do happen where things don't go your way, you could just put it in His hands and not worry about it.
Amen.
That's the great thing, is we have like the ultimate say over everything, that we can just say, all right, God, you handle it. I'm not going to worry about it. Mm-hmm. Oh, I don't know how to pay this electric bill. You pay it for me. Oh, I'm getting a divorce. My husband left me. You work it out. You know, whatever it is, whatever you're going through in your life, it's such a relief to know that He can take anything in your life that's happening that might be bad, and He can turn it to use it for the good.
Yeah.
So why worry when you know that, yeah, there might be bad things that happen, but somehow, some way, God's going to turn that, and He's going to use it to my advantage.
His glory is going to be manifested through what you're going through, and people will be able to see that.
Yeah.
Praise
exactly.
God. Is that something you would like to say as we go to a close, some closing remarks?
I just would like to encourage people just to never give up, never doubt yourself. God loves you so much. He thinks you are worthy. That's the biggest, in my past personal experience, the biggest hold back or pull back for me has always been me doubting my self-worth, or, well, who am I to start a Bible study? I'm a 29-year-old single mother of three girls. My husband left me. I don't have any, you know, who am I to do this? And you, try not to get emotional. Man, the Lord, he's changed my life. Man, he's always been there for me. You know, if you'll just turn to Him and you'll put all your burdens and your problems to Him, He will fix it. He will make it better. And I can't tell you there's how many times when I've just felt hopeless and He's swooped in and He's scooped me up in His big papa loving arms and just told me it's going to be okay and worked everything out. And so the main thing is I just encourage anybody out there who's going through a personal struggle or a life change or anything that it may be, just turn to God, talk to God about it. He's always there. He's always ready and willing to listen, and He's eager to help. He wants to hear your problems. Just give it all over to Him, and it's such a relief when you finally do, when you finally give in to Him. Man, it just is life-changing.
Amen. God bless you. Thank
you.
Thank you
for having me.
So much. It's an honor to have you on the show today. Scripture says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Who but Jesus can say, come unto me, all ye labor and heavy laden, I will give you rest. If you're looking for rest, if you're looking for comfort, if you're looking for security, you're only going to find it in Jesus Christ. Love you. Bye-bye.